Good afternoon. Sorry for Entschuldigung für den etwas späten Beginn. Vielen herzlichen Dank, dass ihr alle hier seid. Your Excellency, dear friends, dear guests, welcome to our two-day symposium of the two-day symposium of the Wittgenstein Initiative on Ludwig Wittgenstein as philosopher, poet, and patron. We continue our quest in finding faces of Wittgenstein which are not known well enough. Apart from the figure of the remote analytical philosopher, we draw attention to his understanding of culture, poetry, music, literature, and to the inner human motivations which drove him to lead the kind of life he considered right. Being in Vienna, the Wittgenstein Initiative looks for Vienna's Wittgenstein through the modernity of in Wittgenstein's Vienna and claims Wittgenstein as one of the essential faces of Vienna, together with Sigmund Freud or Arnold Schönberg. We want to demonstrate Wittgenstein's relevance today and the huge potential of his legacy for our society and especially for the young generation. We are honored to have a partner in the Fritz Ohr Foundation, one of the foremost international leaders in supporting free speech, culture, and arts. We owe a lot to the generous friendship of the Norwegian Embassy and to the cooperation with the Austrian National Library, together with the University of Innsbruck and the City of Vienna. Thanks also to the Austrian State Archive for welcoming us to the Grillparzer Haus, a symbolic place, since Franz Grillparzer's works meant a lot to Ludwig Wittgenstein. Last but not least, I thank all our guest speakers today and tomorrow for being here to share their knowledge and experience with Wittgenstein. Many of them are members of our advisory board of the Wittgenstein Initiative and stood by us from the very beginning as friends and mentors. Now, my main partner in crime, Knut Olaf Omos, in this project, who will chair the two sessions today. Knut Olaf Omos is the executive director of the Fritz Ohr Foundation. He has served as the deputy minister in the Norwegian Ministry of Culture and as the culture opinions and science editor at the daily newspaper Aftenposten. He holds a candidate degree in philosophy and a doctor degree in media studies. He has published 17 books, the last one in January this year, a guidebook to Vienna, and has received several prizes for his journalism and publishing. He's the chairman of the Norwegian government's Media Commission, chairman of the board of the Norwegian Encyclopedia, and a board member at the International Holberg Prize, €500,000, which this year is awarded to Steven Greenblatt. And now, just before I give the word to Knut Olaf, just a small notice about tomorrow's panel on Wittgenstein and modernity. Professor James Conant, unfortunately, is ill and could not be with us here, but we have a fantastic panel consisting of Ray Monk, Marjorie Perloff, and Stephen Beller tomorrow, moderated by Alfred Schmidt, as announced. And I am very grateful to Ms. Perloff and to Mr. Beller for helping us in this way in the last moment. And now I give the word to Knut Olaf. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Radmila. Let me start by introducing our three prominent panelists. Marjorie Perloff. Can you hear me? Yes? Closer? Is this close enough? Radmila is satisfied, but she's sitting only 1 meter from me. Well, I'll ask the other panelists also to keep it close. Marjorie Perloff was born in Vienna, emigrated to the US with her family in 1938, an important year for so many reasons. And she is Sadi Deepatak, Professor Emerita of Humanities at Stanford University, and also Florence Scott, Professor Emerita of English at the University of Southern California. These named American professorships make your titles very long. Lots of names. Professor Perloff is the author of the excellent book, inspired also me very much, Wittgenstein's Ladder, Poetic Language and the Strangeness of the Ordinary, published by Chicago University Press in 1996. And a number of essays on Ludwig Wittgenstein. She has written also a number of books on 20th century poetry and poetics. And her most recent book, I look forward to reading it, it's just out now, is entitled Edge of Irony, Modernism in the Shadow of the Habsburg Empire. Alois Pichler is the head of the Wittgenstein Archives at the University of Bergen in Norway. The Wittgenstein Archives is probably best known for the publication of Wittgenstein's Nachlass, the Bergen electronic edition, Oxford University Press, 2000, and also the open access site, the Wittgenstein Source. The Wittgenstein Source was presented here at the Grillparzerhaus Literaturmuseum a few months ago in November at the Wittgenstein Initiative event. And Pichler is originally from the Südtirol in Italy, but has lived since 1990, more or less in Norway. I remember a young man in his mid-20s coming to Bergen around 1990. Began work at the Wittgenstein Archives exactly that year, and is since 2012 also professor of philosophy at the philosophy department of the university in Bergen. And he has several publications on Wittgenstein and in digital humanities. Kjetil Tredal Thorsen, at your left side in the panel, is a founding partner and director in Snøhetta for almost 30 years. He was educated in Graz in Austria, and you were also a professor at Graz?
Only Innsbruck.
In Innsbruck, yes. Even better. I would say that Professor Thorsen is one of the most interesting architects in the world today. It's an architectural office with a unique philosophy and thinking, very much value-based and concerned about what values in architecture can influence and in what ways. And the Snøhetta staff is really working as a team. The one or two leading names are not stars, though they could be, ranking with or above Renzo Piano and Zaha Hadid, but they are just leaders of their excellent teams. And it's an impressive list of achievements that Snøhetta is behind just the last decade or so. The library in Alexandria in Egypt, the Memorial Museum building at Ground Zero in Manhattan, the total renovation of Times Square, one of the most important public places in the Western world, the new MoMA in San Francisco, the new building for Le Monde newspaper in Paris, and soon to open a vast, big, enormous cultural center in Riyadh in Saudi Arabia, for the first time featuring a movie theater, and also
in Saudi.
Yeah, in Saudi, yeah. And you have also drawn the, is it the National Library in Budapest?
We were competing for it.
You were competing.
We won the competition, but not the job.
You won the competition. Oh. Architecture is a strange profession, winning competitions, but not getting the assignment. You are also competing for President Obama's presidential library and archives. You are one of seven contestants. That will be exciting. And you are working on many very interesting future projects. You are an honorary doctor at several universities. And you are also commander of the Royal Norwegian St. Olav Order. That's the panel. Very good panel. Kjetil is a very modest person. He doesn't like these things to be mentioned. But it's an eminent panel, and all of you in the audience will also be engaged when we have about 20 or 30 minutes left. That is around 5:30. So you are all welcome to take part. Just a few minutes of brief introduction to our topic. Ludwig Wittgenstein spent some of his most important and productive periods in Skjolden, in the Norwegian Sognefjord, between 1913 and 1950, short time before he died. So our questions now in this session are, what did Wittgenstein find? What did he accomplish during his six stays and altogether 2 years in Norway? And why did one of the most important thinkers of the last century choose on several occasions to leave his privileged circles in Vienna and Cambridge and to live in rural parts of Norway, as he did when he chose to live in Austria and Ireland in the countryside? Was he a philosopher and a thinker in some ways dependent on being in exile parts of his life? And how would such a figure be regarded and met today in our society and our academic environments? And to turn a bit physical and take a competent look at his own achievements also as an architect, how does his house in Norway compare to the other house he contributed in building, the Stoneborough Palais here in Vienna? These are some of the interesting questions we will discuss this afternoon with this competent panel and this competent audience. But just a brief introduction to Wittgenstein's time in Norway. I wrote or co-edited two books about this topic more than 20 years ago, together also with Rolf Larsen and Professor Kjellis Johannessen, and I've translated a couple of books by Wittgenstein into Norwegian also. So I have a 25-year long love story, not only with Vienna, but also with Skjolden in the Sognefjord. I have to confess that both the hotels and the food is better in Vienna than in Skjolden. And by the way, I'm very excited by the plans right now to reconstruct and rebuild the Wittgenstein House in Norway. Almost all of the materials are taken care of, and including the timber, the windows, and the roof stones. But they need some money to finalize it. Wittgenstein's opinion of Skjolden, after having spent just 2 weeks there in 1913, was a very positive one. He wrote, "This is an ideal place to work in a letter to Bertrand Russell." And more than 20 years later, he would write something similar to another philosopher, George Edward Moore. He said, "I can't imagine that I could have worked anywhere as I do here. It's the quiet and perhaps the wonderful scenery. I mean, it's quiet seriousness." This stands in a striking contrast to his feelings for Cambridge. He writes in 1947 something which might be pretty typical of his distaste for that place, one of the best university towns in the Western world. He wrote, "I hate Cambridge more and more, the disintegrating and putrefying English civilization." Skjolden and Cambridge, a small, tiny West Norwegian fjord community on the one hand, and one of Europe's intellectual centers on the other. It was perhaps little more than a whim that took Wittgenstein to Norway for the first time, but it was more than that which persuaded him to return so frequently. And his visits to Norway aroused both interest and consternation among his friends and colleagues in Cambridge and his family in Vienna too. Wittgenstein informed Bertrand Russell about his intention to spend more time in the fjords in the summer of 1913. He had been on vacation 1 month in the Hardangerfjord and rushed into Russell's office. And Russell describes the conversation like this. "My Austrian, Wittgenstein, burst in like a whirlwind, just back from Norway, and determined to return there at once, to live in complete solitude until he has solved all the problems of logic. I said it would be dark. He said he hated daylight. I said it would be lonely. He said he prostituted his mind talking to intelligent people. I said he was mad. He said, God preserve him from sanity. God certainly will." Russell adds in a parenthesis. Scholten provided for Wittgenstein conditions for his intellectual work, a fair degree of isolation, not entirely from people, but at least from bourgeois society as he met it in Cambridge and Vienna. So he didn't isolate himself totally in Scholten. Ray Monk describes his relation to this little community very, very well in his brilliant biography on Wittgenstein. Monk writes, "He could be himself without the strain of upsetting or offending people. It was a tremendous liberation. He could devote himself entirely to himself, or rather to what he felt to be practically the same thing, to his logic. That and the beauty of the countryside, ideal for the long solitary walks he needed as both a relaxation and a meditation, produced in him a kind of euphoria. Together they created the perfect conditions in which to think. It was perhaps the only time in his life when he had no doubts that he was in the right place doing the right thing. And the year he spent in Scholten in 1913-14 was possibly the most productive of his life." So he admired the Norwegians he met and their simple human decency, and he demanded simplicity of everybody. Marguerite de Chambrière, or Marguerite Respinger, as her name was when she accompanied Wittgenstein to Scholten in 1931, told me in an interview in 1994. Wittgenstein came to Norway first time in 13 on a vacation, as I said, to Hardanger, came back, stayed from 1913 to 14, working with the foundations of what later became the Tractatus Logico-Philosophicus. Went back to Vienna in the summer of 14, enrolled as a voluntary soldier in the First World War, the Great War, came back to Scholten in the summer of 1921 to take up work in a local factory together with his close friend Arvid Sjögren, and returned again to Scholten in 1931 together with Marguerite Respinger. And then the 16, 14, 15 months in 1936 to 37, from the summer of 36 to the spring of 37, and then he came back and stayed until mid-December in 1937. And he also came back to visit in 1950 with his young friend Ben Richards. So that's some of the facts about Wittgenstein in Norway. And now we will fill in this picture. The panelists have been asked to prepare short statements and introductions, and we start with Alois Pichler. He will dedicate the next 15, 20 minutes to giving an impression of exactly what Wittgenstein did in Scholten during one of his philosophically most productive and intense periods, the fall of 1936. Please, Alois, Professor Pichler.
Thank you, Knut Olav. So, actually, my statement does not be as short, but rather 20 minutes, as we said, because we thought it may be a good idea to get an overview of at least one of the stays in Norway and get more acquainted with the facts and the details about such a stay. And we picked the stay in the autumn of 1936, which was one of the most important stays, some would say the most important, because what we know today as the Philosophische Untersuchungen, philosophical investigations, that started there on the 7th of November 1936. So I'm going to say a few things about what we know about the trip to Scholten, the stay in his house, because it was his house. Sometimes we speak about the house as a hut or a cottage, and I myself maybe in this small presentation sometimes use the word hut, but please correct me, it was his house. And it was his house, like his sister would have a house, and so he wanted to have a house. This was his house, it was his home, at least one of his homes. I'll say a few things about the writing work he did there in the period, and that mainly concentrates around what is called the Brown Book, and then later the Philosophische Untersuchungen, the philosophical investigations. The Brown Book was terminated there in the beginning of November, and the Philosophische Untersuchungen was begun there at the same time. I will conclude with talking about some of the achievements, some of the fruits from this stay. Where do we know these things from? When trying to find out about, can you hear me well, or am I too close to the microphone?
No, fine.
Too close? Yeah. Yeah, okay. Where do we know this from? When I prepared this presentation, I was myself struck by the fact how much we actually can extract of data from Wittgenstein's correspondence with friends, family, colleagues. And here I recommend the Innsbruck Gesamtbriefwechsel Ausgabe. It's a big treasure for finding out so many things, and I have heavily used it and exploited it for this presentation. From his diaries, including the Cambridge pocket diaries, where he would note down travel dates and the like, meetings, but also from his personal diaries, from his philosophical manuscripts, and from we know the things from the reports in by people in Scholten. And what is fascinating is, if you look at all these data which we have from different sources, they very much harmonize. And I would like to speak of Wittgenstein's Selbstdokumentation. He took great care in dating certain important events in his philosophical authorship. And he would sometimes go back to, like, the beginning of the Philosophische Untersuchungen and give it a date. He was himself concerned with recording days where important things happened. So, first to the trip. Here, the Cambridge pocket diaries are important, and they tell us that he left on a certain day in London by boat to Stavanger, which is already on the Norwegian west coast, and from Stavanger he would then travel on to Bergen, and from Bergen up to the Sognefjord and into the Sognefjord, where he then finally would arrive in Scholten on the 19th of August. So Stavanger is down here, up to Bergen and up into the Sognefjord and up into the very end of one arm of the Sognefjord, which is the Lustafjord. This is a screenshot from the webpage of the Wittgenstein Stiftung, the Wittgenstein Foundation, that has been established in Scholten, in the Luster commune, exactly for the purpose, as Knut Olaf already has mentioned, to rebuild the house at its original place, because today the house is not at its original place. To the extent it exists embedded in another house that is in the village. And this Stiftung takes care of preserving the site, because of course the foundations need some preservation. And then also the idea is to really rebuild the house one to one. If we look at these Cambridge pocket diaries, there's an interesting fact. So Wittgenstein would have arrived in Scholten on the 19th of August, but then he notes that he travels back to Bergen. And it's a bit puzzling, why should he travel back to Bergen? This may have to do with the fact that he suffered from some health problems, which we come back to a little bit later. He may have had to see a doctor in Bergen. But this is pure speculation. So the fact is that in the pocket diary, the arrival in Bergen on the 19th is recorded, and then what is recorded is another trip to Bergen. He comes back to Scholten again on August 27. And he notes down in his pocket diary, Einzug in mein Haus. So this was now the event. He's finally at home in his house. And we can imagine him being a sort of relieved and saying to himself, finally, now I can do some work. Because that was one of the purposes of his going to Scholten, to do some philosophical work, to continue with the Brown Book Project, but it will end, and he will start the Philosophische Untersuchungen. A few things about the stay and the house. So it was his house, and it's safe to say that he stayed there from August 27 to December 8, a little bit more than 100 days. We have photographs of the house by Ben Richards. Here you see some. And then we have also a photograph by Wittgenstein. These photographs are in the Cambridge Wittgenstein archive, and also the Cambridge pocket diaries that I have shown facsimiles of are in the Cambridge Wittgenstein archive. We know from a letter by Ben Richards to Georg Henrik von Wright from the 25th of August 1990, what at least, according to Ben Richards' memory, the ground floor looked like. He attached a drawing to the letter. Now, the drawing which you see here is just my representation. This is not Ben Richards' drawing. But from this we know that on this side here, there was the living room with stairs up to the second floor. Probably the entrance was also on this side here, over there, facing the lake, because the house was not above the fjord. It was above the lake, behind the fjord. Facing the lake, there was the bedroom, and behind here would be the kitchen. Quite some scholarly work has been done by architects and architectural students to find out, or at least to derive from architecture principles and from the descriptions we have, what the house on the outside must have looked like and also on the inside. One example is Løken's work from Oslo. Another example is a Spanish architect and scholar's work. Enrique actually did his PhD on Wittgenstein's house in Scholten. And he came up with a map of the inside of the house without knowing of that letter by Ben Richards. And what he came up with pretty much agrees with what Ben Richards described in his letter. Other scholars and two have to be mentioned, in particular David Canerin and Don Phillips. They have invested time and energy and resources in making the public aware of the need to conservate the foundations and to develop a long-term plan for how to preserve the site, including rebuilding the house. And this has been taken up by the already mentioned Wittgenstein Stiftinger, that today works for rebuilding the house at the site. So this is the village of Scholten, and what we have of the house today is down here in the village, while the house originally was over there. And Wittgenstein would mostly reach it by rowing over the lake. Today, then there was also a road, but I don't know how often he would walk along the lake and cross the river there and walk again here and up there to the house. That was rather the much more time-consuming option. So the easiest and the simplest way was simply to row over. And he had sometimes to row into the village to do some grocery shopping and to meet people, to post his correspondence and pick it up. I want to share with you two photographs that I took about 25 years ago in September. It's not good quality photographs, but they give you an impression of the view Wittgenstein would have had in the autumn of 1936 when being on the balcony of his house and watching towards the lake or towards Scholten. From these sources that I have mentioned, oh, is it fine if I just... Can you hear me well? Yes. Okay, so I won't get too close to the microphone. So we know about some practical things, like that he had his health problems in the beginning, gallstone and gallbladder problems, stomach problems. He writes about having to do so much work in the house. I mean, the house hadn't been used for many years. First, he had to spend time on cleaning it, getting things in shape. He had to do the cooking himself, the heating. He went to Scholten for doing some shopping, for meeting people. He reports about beautiful weather in September, and that gave him great joy. And then he complains about the terrible weather that started at the end of October, and he stayed there until the beginning of December. So there was quite some period where he suffered from bad weather. Let's go to a bit more of the correspondence that tells us about how his life there was. He says to Sraffa, "Life here does me good, though it's not easy, or rather for that reason. I live alone in a little house outside the village. I have to do all the housework myself, and it takes a good deal of time. When I came here, I was ill and couldn't recover for some time, but now I'm perfectly well." In a postcard to Moore, he says, "I'm in Scholten again and living in the little house I built for myself or had built for myself before the war. When I came here, I was very ill, but thank God I've recovered now, though I'm still rather weak. My work doesn't go badly considering. I'm very much alone and very undisturbed. I think it may have been the right thing to come here. The country around me is wonderful, and just now we've got fine weather. My house is not on the postcard. It's about half an hour to row and walk from the village." After a letter by George Edward Moore to him, where Moore speculates about the place of the house, he corrects Moore and says, "My house is not built on the site you mean. This map will show you where it is and why I can't get into the village without rowing. For the mountain is much too steep for anyone to walk on it along the lake. We have had the most wonderful weather for the last 4 weeks, though it's already getting cold. The waterfalls are entirely frozen, and it's about -3 degrees Celsius at nights. But I don't suffer from the cold as I would in England, for it's dry." And then he attaches this drawing, and this again is the end of the Sognefjord or Lustefjord with the village of Scholten, and then the lake, and the house would be here, and he explains to Moore that he couldn't walk along this mountain here because it's much too steep, so it's about rowing and walking to the village. A few slides about the work. Now, one of the most important books we have from Wittgenstein, the Philosophische Untersuchungen, called Manuscript 142 in the Nachlass. It's in this house up there in the exhibition. And that book was with him to Scholten. He began it there. He began it there on the 7th of November 1936 and finished it sometime in the spring of 37. there. In the meantime, this is an unresolved issue. But he, well, we can come back to that. Alfred has things to say about that. But he, in the meantime, he may have brought it with him to Vienna and given it to his sister as a present, but then he would have taken it back and continued to write there. So that was one of the writing books he had with him and traveled with him. Another very important item were the notes that were taken by Francis Skinner, one of the two students to whom he dictated the so-called Brown Book. Francis Skinner's actual handwritten notes he had with him to Scholten and translated those English notes into German. So the Brown Book was originally in English, and he tried to produce a parallel German version of it, surely with the idea of publishing them in parallel as his second book. But that was the project he then aborted there in Scholten. He had with him other notebooks. He may also have had the very big typescript, 700 pages of typewritten sheets. At least he had that one with him 1 year later in Scholten. So he had quite a rucksack full of writing books, which he moved with him around. This slide shows you part of that translation and revision of the so-called Brown Book into German, which he did there in Scholten on the basis of Skinner's notes of the Brown Book dictation. And this is a very important page in Wittgenstein's philosophical development. It must have been written around the 7th of November there on the house, and he says, this entire attempt is not worth anything. And then he starts with lots of drafts to what we know today as the first paragraph of the Philosophische Untersuchungen. And at some point he settles on one of these drafts and writes it out, and that one makes it into what he then starts, which is the so-called MS-142, which is in the second or third floor up there, which is today's Philosophische Untersuchung, and he gives it a date, angefangen Anfangs November 1936. This development from the Brown Book Project to the Philosophische Untersuchungen is beautifully summarized in a letter to Moore from November 20, where he, in retrospective, talks about this development. I was glad to get your letter. My work isn't going badly. I don't know if I wrote to you that when I came here, I began to translate into and rewrite in German the stuff I had dictated to Skinner and Miss Ambrose. When about a fortnight ago, around November 7, I read through what I had done so far. I found it all, or nearly all, boring and artificial. For having the English version before me had cramped my thinking. I therefore decided to start all over again and not to let my thoughts be guided by anything but themselves. I found it difficult the first day or two, and hence these drafts, which we find in the notebooks. But then it became easy. And so I'm writing now a new version, and I hope I'm not wrong in saying that it's somewhat better than the last. Besides this, all sorts of things have been happening inside me, I mean in my mind. So one of the big achievements of that autumn 1936 day was the Philosophische Untersuchungen. Another one, or achievement or result, was what is described as Wittgenstein's confession. And it is documented for the first time in a letter to his friend Hensel from November 7, where he says, ich habe dich und mehrere andere einmal in der italienischen Gefangenschaft damit angelogen, dass ich sagte, ich stamme zu einem Viertel von Juden ab und zu drei Viertel von Ariern, obwohl es sich gerade umgekehrt verhält. Diese feige Lüge hat mich lang gedrückt und ich habe diese Lüge, wie viele andere, auch anderen Menschen gesagt. Ich habe bis heute nicht die Kraft gefunden, sie zu gestehen. Ich hoffe, du wirst mir verzeihen. Now, this letter is from the same day as, at least it's plausible, we can date the beginning of the Philosophische Untersuchungen. And in manuscript 183, which is as the manuscript 142 in the Austrian National Library, he also records this event that he now wants to make a confession, and not only to Hensel in correspondence, but he also will then, in the Christmas break, make confessions to his friends and family and colleagues in Vienna and Cambridge. So in this manuscript, which is edited as, published as Denkbewegungen, he says, ich habe vor circa 12 Tagen, written on the 19th of November, for circa 12 Tagen, that's again around the 7th of November, or exactly the 7th of November, an Hensel ein Geständnis meiner Lüge bezüglich meiner Abstammung geschrieben. So, he now decides that he wants to make this confession, maybe even to the locals in Scholden, but he is afraid. This was a very good period in Norway. I think we have little time now, right, Knut Olaf? I wanted to here, I mean, these slides will be put on the web, but only 1 year later, he will have a bad period in Scholden, and he is already on the trip to Scholden, very much afraid of having to live alone in his house there. And in the very end, he decides then to move out of his house and live with Anna Rebny, one of his friends in Scholden. These texts here, which I'm not going to read now, they really show how he, on the one hand, was very attracted and fond of by the solitude he could get on his house in Scholden. On the other hand, how he was afraid of waking up in the morning, as he says, with not having a human face around him. He was the only human on this house. These passages are written in his Geheimschrift. I would like to conclude maybe with a brighter note, where Marguerite Respinger writes on October 1st to him that she would like to be there, and well, maybe I just cite it and then I conclude. Jetzt wird es ja schon recht kalt bei dir sein, aber sehr schön. Spuckst du noch in den See, wenn's wellig ist? Ich mache keinen Spaß, aber ich meine, fühlst du dich noch genauso zu Hause wie seinerzeit? He felt at home there. Am liebsten würde ich dich dort wiedersehen und nicht in Wien, wo man nicht nur einen, sondern sicher 10 steife Kragen anhaben wird, wenigstens ich. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Professor Pichler. And I guess that the audience will have noticed that in Wittgenstein's spirit, none of the men in the panel are wearing stiff collars, no ties, but open shirts. Not a coincidence. Pichler, just a question. Wittgenstein left 20,000 pages of manuscripts and other documents when he died. Do the researchers still find the new manuscripts, documents from Wittgenstein's own hand?
Well,
or mostly letters and correspondence? You know,
there are some items which we assume to exist, but which are declared as lost, or the place of their being is not identified. So right now, in last year or 2 years ago, nothing of the significance of, for example, manuscript 142 has been discovered, but that was only discovered in the 90s. So actually, the manuscript that is up there, that was lost or missing for a long time. I don't know. I mean, you know, it's if we look at the Nachlass, then you would say there must have been a piece between this item and that item, and it's unlikely that it was destroyed by Wittgenstein, so it may be somewhere around. What scholars do today is partly going into the books that Wittgenstein read, and one finds marginal remarks there. So that is one thing which I think is on the horizon right now, where one discovers in lots of books that Wittgenstein read actually his autographs. Yeah.
And most of the physical Nachlass is in the Wren Library
in Cambridge.
Cambridge. But some very important manuscripts also at the Österreichische Nationalbibliothek.
Some very important manuscripts like Tractatus typescripts and the lecture on ethics, which is one of the few statements by Wittgenstein about what he thought we should do with ethics and how we should relate language and ethics. Then this very important Philosophische Untersuchungen item, as also the diary Denkbewegung, published as Denkbewegung, Wittgenstein didn't call it Denkbewegung, which spans over many years. Yeah. So the Austrian National Library has really very important items.
Mm-hmm. Denkbewegungen was published in 1997 and edited in Innsbruck at the Brenner Archive. It's fascinating. Written partly in Cambridge and partly in Scholden, and nowhere else does Wittgenstein reflect so much upon love, religion, the character of his philosophy. And you mentioned that he writes parts of the diaries in Geheimschrift, coded language. Mm-hmm. Why did he write in codes?
Well, there's a distinction between writing in notebooks like the Denkbewegungen or in other notebooks where he usually would not write in Geheimschrift. So he would only write in Geheimschrift in those manuscripts which he thought he would give to friends and which he would give to his colleagues for publishing philosophical remarks from there. So I think, on the one hand, it may have been a way to separate the strictly philosophical. And now we can discuss to what extent are these personal remarks not philosophical remarks. But I think, to him, there was a difference between the philosophical discourse that was in the normal script and the more personal discourse that he, in the notebooks, would also write in normal script. But as soon as they go into this official Bände, that was his idea, would be used by others for extracting publications thereof. He would translate these remarks into Geheimschrift. Mm-hmm. The Geheimschrift schreiben was something which was practiced in the Wittgenstein family, partly, I think, out of simple joy of playing with code. Then he would, in the First World War, in those notebooks, he would write in Geheimschrift those parts that were not the logical or philosophical parts, because he would partly write about his co-soldiers and about the officers, and he didn't want others very easily to see what he says about them. So I would say, at different times, the Geheimschrift Schreiben has had different functions, and in different contexts, different functions.
Thank you, Alois Pichler.
Thank you.
We'll turn to a related topic. Wittgenstein once wrote that working in architecture is really like philosophy, a work on oneself, or working with oneself. And he produced his own business card, proudly stating, Ludwig Wittgenstein, architect. Let's give the floor to another architect now, Kjetil Tredal-Thorsen.
Thank you very much. Thank you so much. Well, as you say, Knut Olav, what I'll be trying to do is to look at this from an architectural perspective, basically. Some of the things are definitely open for debate. Some of the things that I've been looking for while looking at the places, the houses, and the rooms might be pure hypothetical, and I'm open to any type of slaughter after this. But let's just assume that there is this assumption in architecture that the influence between your physical surrounding is influencing your mental state of mind. Let's assume that architecture and thinking belongs together somehow in the spaces where you create what you're creating. As we know, even in Wittgenstein's case, probably spent more than 90% of his life indoor. So you have to assume that the surroundings that you brought up within and the way you actually perceive yourself as a person in a space in relationship to your own perspective, meaning where is the horizon? The horizon is always where you are and where your eyes are. So maybe with that assumption, maybe there are some connections between the places, the houses, and the rooms that he actually spent some time within. And maybe just starting with his childhood Vienna, as you know, big city at the time already, had a lot of influence in the intellectual world and was a hub. It was buzzing. It was amazing what was happening. And of course, the father was very rich and a steel magnate. And he grew up in a palace, in the Wittgenstein Palace in Vienna. Quite obviously, this type of setting in the palace, as we know from these spaces inside, really in the end were also the first spaces where he was taught. So from the very beginning, the parents kept him away from school. So he had education at home. Now, what does that actually mean? It means that from the time when others socialize in certain aspects of society, starting schools, he was kept at home because his father was afraid of the influence from others. Now, what does that mean? It means from the very first beginning, he is brought into a situation of working at home. He is connected to the place where he's actually working from the very beginning. And that we will see in the involvement much later when he, for instance, lived in the Loewe institution where, by the way, Gustav Mahler died and when he was living there. It is a by coincidence. But again, a lot of these places where he stayed, he would also work. And that was part of the notion. I think there is an assumption, at least, to be made that his relationship to the place where he works is as much the nature as the space. Now, if you look at Linz, just where he started school and sort of started socializing, I didn't find much. Maybe there is a lot of stuff about Linz, but in any case, it didn't seem that socializing was part of what that period meant. So it was kind of probably a little bit lonesome. You have to correct me if I'm wrong. But then, of course, moving to Berlin under some influence and studying at the Technische Universität in Berlin also influences a large sort of educational facility, very classical in the sense, mathematics. And then starting to promote the engineer in Wittgenstein, where he starts really looking at himself as somebody that might be a future inventor, almost, like putting himself into a position of type of research that again would influence him, which is the reason, of course, why he then moved to Manchester, and typically also in Manchester, at that time, really ugly city, one would have to assume, very dark. He, of course, immediately moves out of Manchester. So what does he do? He puts himself again in a lone position in Manchester, stayed a long time in something called the Grouse Inn. Inside Manchester, he, of course, lived in also an apartment where he pulled himself back into the spaces and into rooms. It's not that he doesn't spend the time outside and, for instance, fly the dragons here for the research he's doing on aeronautic. And he actually made a patent while in Manchester, I believe, on the propellers with a jet motor connected to each propeller, which is still a patent pending. And in a way, it's this type of research relationship to the landscape, the possibilities that he has. And I think if you look at the places which he chose more and more consciously when it came to the landscapes are getting more and more, let's say, conscious as he grows older. It seems that there are decisions made which amounts to the level of sky or even, as we will see later, the level of water and the amount of water that he's actually surrounding himself with. So Cambridge, of course, he hated because it was part of the things that he was trying to get away from in Vienna. And also, of course, that notion of the spaces which he shared are austere. you know, he pulls back, it's reduced, and we will see issues and similarities in the Schuldenhaus actually related to his chambers of Cambridge, which is kind of fascinating because the space in itself is generic. It has windows, it had openings, it has furniture. So a space in Schulden might have been also in Cambridge, but we don't know. At least what we do know is that it moves in direction of what we would call barefoot architecture. It is reduced. It's been described as minimalist by a lot of people. It's not minimalist, people. It's reductionist. It means you reduce away everything that you don't need. You sort of go back to the spare elements of a house, the spare elements of a sofa. The chair is the prototype of a chair. The bed becomes the prototype of a bed. He's not, in that sense, interested in the type of design that it might give, but is interested really in the structure and the function. Very similar to what happens when he moves back later to Vienna and looks into modernism in the collaboration and influence under Adolf Loos, and maybe even to the extent some other more earth-grounded architects like Holzmeister or other people at the same time. So we will see this. But also, quite simply, the elements of space that he moves into are reduced. They're not minimalist. So what happens in Schulden? Okay, we've heard already about the travels there, but what type of landscape is this? Is he really escaping, or is he looking for a beautiful place? Or is he, in effect, protesting? Or is he doing all three at the same time? We don't know. I don't know. Maybe you know. But in effect, he doesn't choose a location which is so far away from people that you could say he really escaped. We have lots of examples of people who move so far away that you have to walk for days in order to get to somewhere. So it's half an hour. It's easy, accessible, compared to many other farms in Norway at the same time. It is really not a remote location in that sense. But it is peaceful. It is far away from things. And the sounds that you hear are the sounds of nature. You don't hear any other sounds. And the smells that you have are the smells of nature. So in effect, maybe the choice is a very specific choice right in between a position of wanting to be seen and at the same time just remote enough to be seen that you want to be remote. So in effect, he's sort of basing himself on this middle position. And also the location of the house is a visual location of the house. The house can be seen from far away. It's not hidden in the forest. It's not put away. And it's really sitting there like a really brave kind of animal with its back turned towards the landscape, 90 degrees, and really showing itself to its surroundings. Now, I'll get back to that, but that is, of course, the Tyrolean style of houses that we see because they are 90 degrees to the landscape, and all of them struggle against the fall of the steepness of the sides. But he doesn't build the house in steps. He builds a platform with a stone wall in order to get a horizontal platform, and then he puts a simple house on top. And I totally agree, it's not a hut. It doesn't have any characteristics of a hut. It has all the characteristics of a house. Now, the way there, if you come there sometime, and you should really go because it's the most fabulous route, also walking, is really nice because the landscape and the trees are old. It's an old landscape. You can feel it when you walk through there. The plants, everything, the tightness, the density of the planting is very different from the alpine density. But it is very dense, very green. And as we've heard already, he would approach his location by rowing over. And these pictures are known pictures. We see the house. You see it across the lake. It's located like a castle. It's not located like someone who wants to hide himself away from people. And I'm thoroughly surprised by the fact that this sort of emotional location in a place means that you capture the place. It means you take ownership of that particular place. So there's no way that he would describe it only as his house. He would describe it as his place also, I'm quite certain. And you can see that also how the landscape around the house has been dealt with in close connection, where he locates the door and how he locates the balcony, which of course comes exactly from here. This is the typology. And it's no wonder that the locals in Norway, in Skjolden, would call it Austria, because it really carries the structure of earthbound architecture in that particular location. You know, we have plenty of these interpretations, and they're hanging in us from all the way until now, you know. Yeah, it's from your...
My place. Yeah.
I know. But you know, even Zaha Hadid is working on these type of things, pushing the proudness of the object 90 degrees to the slope of the landscape. That means you can withstand almost anything. But what does the Norwegians do when they then move the house from this location? They turn the house 90 degrees to the landscape, of course. It's crazy. It's an absolute nightmare. And they hide it away into Eternit, like sort of very poisonous concrete claddings, which everybody did during the 60s. So, just to say, inside this house is Wittgenstein's house. It's kind of fascinating that you take it away, you turn it 90 degrees, and you move it away from a very visible place. There you have the difference between the philosopher in Skjolden and the farmer in Skjolden. They are not the same, and they will never, ever produce the same type of house. Now also, we shouldn't forget, it's the only house he actually designed and thought about for himself. All the other places were ready-mades, almost, in the way he moved into them and looked at them. And I couldn't support enough, in fact, the attempts that are now being made to reconstruct the house. It's a must. I'll get back to that in the end. But you know, all these places, Buchberg, landscapes, mountains, water is coming in. Trattenberg, same thing. Philosophical houses, beds, places that he where he slept. Prototypes of furniture, which reflect exactly his almost, I mean, I don't know if you can use the word, but simplicity. Might be a word in that case, where you sort of things are extraordinarily complex, but the expression is totally reduced. Now, Killary Harbour, the same thing. It's a fjord landscape. So already here, you will see looking for certain types of views. I believe there is a characteristic in why he chose Skjolden, where you have two layers of horizontal water. You have the lake and you have the fjord, and they are different heights, and they produce different horizons. And I think these two horizontal elements, which is the same here in Ireland, is that he needed the horizontal with the vertical. That's why he didn't choose valleys without water, which he easily could have done. Or he didn't choose only the coastline with only water. He needs this contrast, verticality and horizontality. He would live in these different houses, pulled back, and always be in this type of situation. So what is the difference when he designs for somebody else? I mean, he wasn't commissioned to design the house here in Vienna, the Wittgenstein house. Paul Engelmann was commissioned to design the house, but Margaret, the sister, asked him, can you please help out because you don't have anything else to do? So he said yes, and as you know, now it's a cultural center, Bulgarian cultural center, but it's typical for the time. It's also, I don't think that when Wittgenstein moved into the design of architecture that he necessarily came from a modernist movement, or that he was thinking so much about it. It was became almost natural as a counteractive situation to whatever he felt would be close to himself. I think, in fact, he could have imagined to live in a house like this. He could have. He would never do it, but I think in his imagination he could have imagined to live in this house sort of designed out of these three blocks. But the fact of the matter is, the sister didn't like it either, and he kept changing the things, and there were big fights on the building site, and it was typical for the time. The spaces and the details and the level of aesthetic following his design through this house must have been a terrible drain on everyone involved. Like, for instance, at the end, he would lift the roof 30 centimeters or 3 centimeters in order to get the proportions of a space right, or he would sort of move back and design the most incredible things. Just to say, give you one example before I end. He spent maybe more than a year designing these door handles. Only that. to the perfection of the bending, to the perfection of the weight in the hand. As you know, when you use a door handle, it depends on where you have the hand. So just by twisting it slightly asymmetrically, the weight and the proportion of that door handle was turned into perfection. Nobody else would ever spend a year on designing door handles. Now, if you see the preservation of this, now I'm ending, in contrast to this, I can only say I'm ashamed. Because in effect, now it's high noon that we actually get back to understand exactly these contents. I don't think you can understand a person's full life history without really understanding the places, the houses, the rooms that they spent their time in. So thank you.
Thank you so much, Kjetil Tredal-Thorsen. There will be a Wittgenstein and Vienna culture seminar in Sogn this coming weekend, and this foundation which is working on reconstructing the house will then give us an update on how it's going. And it might be recreated as a house for academics, authors, architects, possibly to rent for periods of time. Would you like a few months in this site in
100 Jordan? Days?
Yes, 100 days. Yeah. Could you also have lived in the Stoneborough Wittgenstein Palais here in Vienna?
No, probably not.
Why not?
To some extent, it's today it would represent too much of a certain position that you would have to take within the architectural world. Let's put it that way. So I have to be detached from the architectural world in many ways in order for me to be able to do whatever I'm doing. I don't like designing things for myself at all. Yeah, it feels like a doctor operating out his own appendix. You know, it's kind of very difficult to do. So no, I probably couldn't.
No, I think I could.
I know you could.
I mentioned in the start that not just the hotels are better in Vienna than in Scholden, and the food, but also the houses.
They are, for sure.
By the way, have you taken a patent or a copyright on this word simplexity? Is it your...
No, it's a word game I do all the time. because some elements simply work better in two languages, one language in combination. I used the word marvelhaft, for instance, because I think haft is...
Marvelhaft.
Marvelhaft instead of marvelous, because I think haft is more descriptive. Is more descriptive of whatever it contains, and marvel is marvel. So I think I do these games all the time. I like it in architecture also. So.
You're a very philosophical architect.
No, I'm not very. Not. I just like words.
Playful architect, then. Well, thank you again.
Thank you.
Now we are very much looking forward to hear the introductory remarks of Professor Marjorie Perloff. While we are awaiting your next book, which we are also very eager to.
Yeah, it's here.
You have it? Aha. Congratulations. Edge of Irony. Please.
Thank you so much. I'm delighted to be here. I lost my voice on the plane, but I'll try to talk low. I don't have slides for this particular talk. When Red Milosz-Weitz asked me to speak on Norway, I said, well, I'm really an outsider. I have no special insights. I'm a literary person on Norway. But actually, when I started looking into it, I did find some things I thought were very interesting. Now, first of all, when you read your wonderful book and the various things you always read about solitude and the fact that Wittgenstein chose Norway as he then later went to Ireland, in order to be alone, to get away, the solitude, the beauty, all those usual things, and we've seen the wonderful pictures. So we've talked about that already. That's true, but when I started looking into it, I realized he wasn't so isolated, as you said too, that not only did he know some of the farmers and carpenters and so forth in the town, but he went first with David... And then with Francis Skinner, David Pinson, Francis Skinner, and then with Ben Richards. So he wasn't alone all the time. And I think one thing that I feel is that the feeling for Norway has a great deal to do with Wittgenstein's sexuality, which is still very little talked about, oddly. It's odd because there is so much with other people, but with Wittgenstein, for some, all kinds of reasons, we stay away from it. Now, you know, in the United States, we often compare Wittgenstein to Gertrude Stein, just because of the names, kind of pun, and because they have certain things in common. And Gertrude Stein lived in Paris because she couldn't really live in the United States at the time, because her whole lifestyle with Alice B. Toklas and so forth wouldn't have been acceptable back in Baltimore or in the United States. And I think there is an element of that in Wittgenstein. After all, you know, and this is always sort of, in many of the things one reads, has kind of passed over, to have three older brothers who committed suicide. I don't even know how you continue to live when you know that. I mean, it's not just a small thing. And even if it wasn't talked about at home and so on, it's a very big thing. And there were certainly also aspects of sexuality in terms of, I don't know whether all three brothers, but there was definitely a problem in that case. And for Wittgenstein to come back to Vienna after his father died was very difficult. He did come back, of course, when his father was ill, and I think reconciled himself to his father in many ways and felt his father had lived a very good life and had a good death. But the mother was very difficult for Wittgenstein to get along with, clearly. And he did go back for Christmas when he had to, but he writes repeatedly that he doesn't want to have to come home. Oh, I have to go home for Christmas. My mother expects me. It'll be terrible. And then when he's there, I won't get any work done. I'm not getting any work done. One can't work in Vienna. Well, of course, the reason he couldn't work in Vienna was because there's the very bourgeois class structure, and you're expected to appear at all these things, and you have to dress properly and do all these things. And that was something he really obviously wanted to get away from. And beginning with the first trip with David Pinson in 1913-14, and then the trip in the mid-30s, the time in the mid-30s, and later in the 50s with Ben Richards, all of whom, by the way, were much younger. Skinner was 20, Wittgenstein 43, when they became friendly in Cambridge, and their relationship became intimate, and Skinner was very dependent on Wittgenstein. In any case, so I think there's all that difficulty. But then I thought, well, what was the difficulty in Cambridge? And the difficulty in Cambridge, as you both pointed out in some ways, was just as difficult, although in a different way. Cambridge, of course, had a huge gay community. The Bloomsberries were notable, are notable. And Wittgenstein's one close Bloomsbury friend was Keynes, John Maynard Keynes, the great economist. He was very friendly with Keynes, but he didn't like Lytton Strachey. He didn't like Virginia Woolf. He didn't like the whole crowd. And one thing he didn't like about them is that they were always talking about sex, very obviously, which he felt as a good Viennese, maybe, I don't know, so one doesn't do that. One doesn't talk about things. One doesn't behave in certain ways. And he once... Edward Kantarian in his book records that he once walked out of a lunch at Cambridge because sex was discussed in the company of women. And he found that so annoying that we're sitting around with these women, and that's all the Bloomsberries did. Those of you who know the letters of Virginia Woolf, Leonard Woolf, Strachey, all these people, the apostles, the Cambridge apostles, they talked about it nonstop. Who's sleeping with whom? Who's here? Who's what? Now, Wittgenstein thought this is just an impossible discussion, and that was certainly not part of his life. He did not want to discuss that. One doesn't talk about such things. I mean, remember, it's Freud's Vienna, too. It's always important to remember that, I think, that there are certain things that are not part of the culture. Whereas I'm always surprised when I do read the Quentin Bell letters, they're all published now, and of course all the various Virginia Woolf letters, the way they talk about it nonstop, as if this is what we do as opposed to our Victorian ancestors. So Wittgenstein didn't really fit in Cambridge either. He was very friendly with F.R. Leavis, who wasn't gay. You know, he had his certain friends there, but he also needed to get away from Cambridge. So I look at Norway as a place where not only the positive elements, but it was the ideal place to get away because there wasn't that class structure. He didn't have to be part of a bourgeois world at all, and he could be left alone, and he could really work. So it was an ideal place to work. Not have these sort of holiday, you know, situations. And later references in his diary, when he writes even about Ben Richards, he's so glad that Ben Richards came with him to Norway briefly, even though he didn't stay very long. That always made things better. So I do think that's a very important factor and could be studied more. Now, as I was looking into all that, I came across this unpublished archive that's in Trinity College that has just been discovered, which I think will shed more light on this situation. I'll just read you this. I just found this online. This is just a month ago that this was discovered. A hitherto unpublished archive left by the world-famous philosopher Ludwig Wittgenstein, who died 60 years ago on 29th April 1951, is being edited at his Cambridge College for publication. Provides new insights, so forth. Now, the archive, which comprises many different manuscripts, is being examined at Trinity College, where Wittgenstein was senior research fellow, later professor of philosophy. It was given to the Mathematical Association in the 1970s by its former president, Professor Reuben Goodstein, you know about that, who was a student of Wittgenstein. And many of the manuscripts are in the handwriting of Francis Skinner. Most of these manuscripts are in Skinner's handwriting, who plays a leading role in the story of the archive, both as Wittgenstein's friend and Amanuensis, assistant and scribe. One of the most interesting manuscripts urges us to look for the unknown in the familiar as a means of unlocking new ways of thinking. Arthur Gibson, the philosopher Arthur Gibson, I don't know, known for his original work, was invited to study the archive and is working on it now. And I just thought this part was interesting. Let me read you this paragraph. The archive comprises two boxes of manuscripts, books, and papers. When Professor Gibson first opened the boxes, he was stunned by what lay before him. The two boxes contain a series of dictated lecture notes in Skinner's handwriting, with Wittgenstein's own handwritten revisions and corrections. A series of exercise books contain a verbatim manuscript record of material dictated by Wittgenstein to Skinner, with Wittgenstein's later amendments. These consist of the work that is now known as the Brown Book, with a revised opening, some other changes, an additional 60 pages of manuscript, together with exercise books and papers containing dictation completely unknown to Wittgenstein's scholars. Also preserved is a charming Norwegian school exercise book with a sequential text which appears to date from Wittgenstein's stay in Norway in the late 1930s. Among the exercise books is one with a pinkish cover, and that seems so funny to me, the pink is your pink gay color, pinkish cover, containing a complete and unknown narrative with many visual illustrations. This may or may not be the missing item called the pink book or yellow book that scholars have been hoping for, says Professor Gibson. So I think it is interesting that the relationship to Skinner is so close. And of course, Professor Monk, who's here, points this out in his biography at some length, but it isn't actually the relationship with Skinner is very interesting, and I think still not talked about enough for this reason. Skinner's parents hated Wittgenstein. They thought he was leading their son astray. He was a brilliant young philosophy student who came to Cambridge. Next thing you know, all he's doing is walking around, you have the one picture of him, with Wittgenstein. And then Wittgenstein did what he often did to people in a strange way. He said, Skinner, you don't want to become a philosopher. You should do something practical and mechanical. It's a waste of time for you to become a philosopher. So Skinner worked in this shop and did various mechanical things and worked with machines. His parents were outraged. You know, their wonderful son, who had a great future as a philosophy professor, is just kind of hanging out with this older Austrian. You know, look at it from that point of view. It was complicated. It was clearly very complicated. And then when Skinner died, which is terribly sad, Skinner died in 1941 of polio, was one of the first victims of polio, and Wittgenstein was devastated, but he also wrote in his diary that he felt guilty for not grieving enough. Guilty for not grieving enough. I have great remorse at my lovelessness. In other words, by this time he was sort of tired of Skinner in a way, and then he felt he should be grieving more, but he didn't quite, and it was a very tricky thing and changed his time. Now, I think it'll be interesting when this notebook has gone through, in Skinner's handwriting and lots of emendations, that he was really a part of the thinking that went on and a very important figure. And all that is related to Norway and getting away and being in a place that does become a kind of Eden in a way. I mean, this ideal place where you're alone, but not really alone, not so alone, and can work out these things and work out these problems. So that, to me, was the interesting thing about the Norway story. Now, it repeats itself, of course, later with Ireland a little bit, although that's different. But later on, when he had to get out of Cambridge, he went to Ireland. And, of course, you can say the trip to Russia was a little bit a part of the same thing again. When Skinner went to Russia, also to get away, another world, there must be a better world. Now, the irony, though, is that, as Wittgenstein says, I am German through and through, I'm Austrian through and through. He was so Viennese, he had a love-hate relationship, and I think that tension fills his work and his life because he's in exile. You always have to think of Wittgenstein, after all, like so many other modernists, we'll talk more about this tomorrow, as an exile writer. He spends most of his time, his working life, away from Vienna, in England, and finally becomes a British citizen after all. And that's where his main work, except in Norway, is done. So on the one hand, he's in exile. And on the other hand, he's completely devoted to Vienna and completely imbued with those values. So you have that notion that that tension was a very productive tension. And the idea of always being away and not having to be part of that. And he couldn't properly work. I don't think there's any really important work that he did do in Vienna, but I'm not sure. Because the Tractatus, after all, was mostly composed then during the war. First on the ship, then on the Italian front. And I want to say something about the notebooks. When we talked about the coded notebooks, I also think the coded notebooks are very important for his sexuality, because he does say in those notebooks written during the war that he masturbated, what he did, and that he's ashamed of that, and he shouldn't have done that, and so on. And that's what you get in the coded notebooks. So clearly, there are always these two sides. It's also very interesting to me that when he made his confession, the confession to Tanya, what's her last name?
Fania Pascal.
Pascal, and the various other people, and you put it on the board. He confessed about being Jewish, but he didn't confess anything about his sex life. He didn't want to talk about that. That was very much part of the time, probably, but it wasn't something he was going to talk about. At the same time, he did live openly with Francis. Of course, who knows what the relationship quite is, in Cambridge, so it isn't that he try to hide it, except there's the whole relation with Marguerite. But incidentally, the account in Monk's book of when Marguerite came to Norway, the trip was a sort of disaster. She did come on that visit, and they thought it would be very nice, but it obviously didn't work out. That was a failure, and she left. And after that, that was the end of the possibility of marriage and so forth, because that didn't work out, because they didn't really have enough in common, and it was not right, that did not going to work. So that's all I really want to bring up.
Thank you very much, Professor Perloff. You described yourself as an outsider in this field. Well, some outsider, and my own experience is that people, thinkers from other professions than philosophy itself, people from architecture, arts, history of ideas, often have the most stimulating perspectives on Wittgenstein and Wittgenstein's works, and I think you are one example. We really look forward to reading your book on modernism in the shadow of the Habsburg Empire. But let's turn now to Wittgenstein's sexuality. There are several people in the audience also who could jump into the discussion of this topic. Alois Pichler, why do you think the question of Wittgenstein's sexuality is a topic so little discussed, relatively little discussed, or is that a wrong assertion?
Well, within the philosophical reception of Wittgenstein, one would think that this is not a topic. That first of all, many would think that biography is not a topic of philosophy, and Wittgenstein was first of all received by the analytical philosophical community, and definitely their biography and how ideas come about and who comes about? Who brings these ideas, and what's his, her life history is not relevant for them. So they would think that sexuality is of no concern for understanding a philosopher as a philosopher. Then in addition, the trustees to whom Wittgenstein entrusted the management of his Nachlass, they would think that focusing on Wittgenstein's sexuality would lead away from more important things in discussing and receiving his work. And that was probably one of the reasons why they didn't want Wilhelm Baum to publish what was called the secret code diaries, or the secret diaries, which are not diaries on their own. They are simply the secret code passages in the First World War diaries. Because, as Professor Beloff said, there he records about masturbation. He records his reflection about his sexuality, and along with other very, very intimate and personal reflections and matters. So they would have thought that this will do harm to understanding Wittgenstein as a philosopher and use him, utilize his ideas in the best possible way. Now, the argument how you connect his sexuality with his philosophical ideas, that is a very difficult argument to make, but I don't know. I do not want to exclude that one can really make the connection and bridge not only biography and philosophy, but also sexuality and philosophy of language.
Mm-hmm. I'm a biographer myself. I wrote a biography about a Norwegian poet. But works of art or of thinking should and shouldn't and in many cases couldn't be reduced to biography, or biography is in very few cases able to throw perfect light on professional work. But biography is also an important academic achievement. Mm-hmm. It is a part of several scholarly fields, and it's a very difficult academic task. I think that I see all the time claims that it's not relevant enough. It's not relevant to understand this fact of life in order to understand a piece of work or a whole oeuvre. What do you think about this perspective, Professor Perloff?
I think this is very strange because I'm the opposite. I mean, in the United States, but in England too, the tendency is now with everybody to overplay it. Everything is gendered this and sexual that. It's, you know, done to death. I certainly don't believe in that. But I think the only thing one can really say is that it makes you different. And Wittgenstein always says, I believe in difference. When he said Hegel, we were talking about this earlier today, that Hegel took different things and always looked for the similarity. I always take similar things and look for the difference. And there is a way of being different, sensing yourself as somehow different without talking about it all the time, necessarily. So you can't say too much. You can't say a philosophy is you know, conditioned by biography, but of course everything is, in some sense, is. I mean, we're talking about Wittgenstein's culture, Wittgenstein's Vienna. I mean, here we are in Vienna having this meeting and the relation to the houses he lives in, which is very important. All these things, after all, do make a difference. And so I think, as I say, it only struck me because when everybody said he went to Norway to be alone, and then when I really read about it, including reading what you said, he wasn't alone. He wasn't, a lot of the time, he was not alone. He took these three lovers on, these three friends, let's say, on these trips. Now, that's not just coincidental. I mean, that meant something. And so you can't just ignore it. And clearly it makes some difference, but perhaps no more difference than that being a little bit an outsider perspective. Now, you can say, isn't every writer an outsider? But first of all, I also want to say about philosophers that we now realize that in terms of Heidegger, even all the editors of the Black Notebooks have now admitted that it does have something to do with your biography. So I think the notion that philosophy has nothing to do with biography is just plain wrong. I mean, I don't even understand how anybody can say that. Clearly, I'm not saying it should be reduced to biography. Nothing should. And it's hardest, I think, with composers, where you always feel biographies are so incommensurate. When you read Mahler's biography, you really don't get at the music. It's different with somebody who uses language, because then, you know, you have more material. But I just don't see, I know it's common to say that, but to say that, that's what the Heidegger defenders always say, to say that philosophy has nothing to do with one's life, to me it just seems absurd. And maybe that's an extreme position, because of course it relates to your life. How do you develop certain ideas? It doesn't just come out of some kind of vacuum. There are all kinds of things that have to do with your life, I think.
And one follow-up question. Wittgenstein came from Vienna, Freud's Vienna, a society in many ways obsessed with sex 100 and 120 years ago. And some of his circles in Cambridge, as you mentioned, the Bloomsbury people in London and the apostles in Cambridge, they were also talking about sex all the time, as you said. Could his many exiles be seen in this light as a way of well, it could be seen as a way of escaping, but he reports about having a sex life also in Norway, and could we compare the question of his sexuality to his ambiguous relation to his own Jewishness also? Could any of you develop any thoughts on this? The question might be a bit unclear. There is some fog in my head right now. Professor Pichler.
I think his relation to his own sexual orientation and sexual practice would have been much more positive and unburdened than his relation to Jewishness. He struggles quite a bit with Jewishness and struggles with not succumbing to stereotypes about Jewishness. So I think he would feel more comfortable with his sexuality than with the fact that he has related to Jewishness and to think about Jewishness. But may I add something to your previous question? I mean, I would definitely, we have to see that for Wittgenstein, philosophical problems, as he says, are personal problems. So there is the connection between philosophy and the personal. And he says philosophical problems are not problems of the intellect, they're problems of the will. It's a philosophical problem is there because we do not want to accept reality as it is. It's a problem of the will. So there is the connection clearly between the personal and the philosophical. But I think it's a very difficult enterprise to become specific about how the personal informs the private language argument, how the personal informs the rule-following problem, and so on. So there's no easy way from the personal to the philosophical problem in the ways we are used to discuss Wittgenstein's philosophy, at least. So then you can say, well, that's the problem. Mm. We have all the time detached his philosophy of language from the personal. Mm-hmm.
Professor Perloff, would you like to add?
Well, I think the question of the Jewish is interesting, and what it lets me think is this. On the one hand, Wittgenstein is the ultimate insider. He lives in a palace, the beautiful palace we just saw, the son of the richest father, the most inside Vienna family, who has all the composers over, knows all the right families. You know, it's sort of what everyone else would dream of, living that life in the palace, and how wonderful it is. And then there's always that side that isn't where it isn't quite right. But of course, that side is already there. And I say in the notion that he grows up having three older brothers who have committed suicide. Do we know any other great man or anybody, perhaps? Of course, you have to have a large family to even have the question be relevant. Who has that many suicides? in a family. Think of how that would affect your thinking right there. Now, why? Why did the other three commit suicide? And with the second brother, the one who committed suicide on the bar in Berlin, it is also supposed, it is implied by Monk and I think Guinness in the biographies, that it was also because of not being able to face the father and face the family because of homosexuality. And the Jewishness ties right in. It's double, and after all, we haven't talked about Weininger, but you know, in the United States in general, people get very upset and angry at Wittgenstein because he liked Weininger. You always have to excuse him for it and say, just the same, he's a great man, even if he liked Weininger, because of Weininger. But after all, why was he so interested in Weininger? Where there's, again, the issue of Jewishness, the issue of sexuality, these things within oneself that are problematic. And it's also the fact, and this would have to relate to philosophy somehow, if you compare him, say, to Moore, to G.E. Moore, or to Russell, is that Wittgenstein only deals with other men, except for Elizabeth Anscombe, and he calls her the honorary man. She's an honorary man. That's how he can deal with Elizabeth Anscombe. So he only deals with other men. As a woman, I'm very sensitive to that. I mean, it's very peculiar in some ways to have somebody whose entire intellectual life, 100%, is with men, which wouldn't be true in many cases, you know, where there would be a relationship with a woman that might be very important, as it is for many poets, as it would be for Rilke, to take a contemporary, you know, to take other people. So the idea that it's these male relationships, which are by no means all homosexual, of course, his close friends, Drury, Ramsey, you know, these various people, but it is a different way of moving and thinking and arguing. So I'm sure eventually people will write about it. There is that one book by Bartley, which I gather everybody thinks is awful. I have that book.
No, not so awful.
I mean, I'm not making any case for Bartley, who argued, you know, may try to make a very obvious kind of case for it. But as far as that philosopher, for instance, in the case of Nietzsche, surely much more is talked about the life, probably, right? I don't know. I'm not a philosopher, so I don't know. But it's true that when first study philosophy, you think this should have nothing to do with the life at all. But everything in the world does. So sooner or later, you know, connections are made, which does not mean you spend your time working on biography, and I'm certainly no biographer. But I think it comes in more than it has been said to come. Mm-hmm.
But
Kjetil?
No, it's just a comment. In Wittgenstein's case, it just feels as if biography might be even more relevant than in many other cases. Simply because of the devotion to certain different descriptions of himself. I mean, he was not only on his car, but he was a registered architect in Vienna. So he described himself as an architect. He wanted to be seen as an architect in Vienna, not as a philosopher. So in this sequence of things, maybe biography is even more interesting in his particular case than in many others, because it's so extremely interwoven in whatever he does and how he describes himself and what professions he is sort of passing.
Yes, and the relationship to Engelmann is very interesting. And then, by the way, when he's teaching in Kirchbach am Weg, when he's in teaching, and Hermine, that's in the letters from Hermine, when Hermine wants to come visit him, he practically has a fit. I found that part so amusing. Don't come. I don't want you to come. You know, and of course it seems like such a great distance. How many miles is it? Kilometers is it from Kirchbach to Vienna? 80. I know, 80. I live in Los Angeles where we think 80 kilometers, you just drive, you know, for lunch, sort of in that way. Anyway, so he don't come, you know, don't come. And really didn't want her to visit. And that was partly because he said that people will know I'm a Wittgenstein, you know. So that's why he didn't want her to come. But it's also just, it's invading my space, as we would say today. And when Gretel is in London, oh my God, she's going to be in London. I have to go to Norway. I have to get away. So that's
thank you. Alois Bichler?
I would like to add one thing to this discussion. It is true that the personal, of course, influenced his philosophy. It is true that he wrote lots of remarks about his intimate relations, about his sexuality in the Nachlass. The fact is, when it comes to what he prepared for us as his philosophic legacy, first the Tractatus and then the Philosophische Untersuchungen, he didn't include those remarks. So when we want to know what is the philosophy he wanted to leave with us, it was not texts that included anything about sexuality. So I just wanted to say this is a telling fact. Philosophy, in his understanding, is still something which seems to be understandable and practicable without knowing about the sexual in his life.
Thank you very much. We'll open up for the audience now. I have promised first to give the floor to Professor Alan Janik. There is no single person during the last 50 years who have done more to show us Wittgenstein's contexts than Professor Janik. Please, Alan.
Thank you. Okay. Thank you. It's going to be very, very hard to keep quiet after all of this. Plenty of things that I'd like to, I'd like to jump in on. But this is your game. I just want to remember somebody, a man who now must be about 85 years old, who is the person more than any single person responsible for us being here today, Ivar Oxhall. No one, I'm sure, here, except those of us who are friends of his, have ever heard this name. But Ivar, in two ways, has contributed to the interest of everybody in this room. As Stephen Beller probably can tell you best, Ivar read Wittgenstein's Vienna. He's, they're all Jews. Now, Ivar is an expert on race relations in the Caribbean. But he also got the idea, well, we should know more about these Viennese Jews. He wrote his working papers from 1985. It's the first modern contribution to the sociology of the Viennese Jewish community. Everybody who's ever written about this, the Jewish community and its sociology since then, you'll find a footnote to Ivar Oxhall. So Wistrich writes 1,000 pages, but in this crucial discussion, he cites Oxhall. Now, that's his contribution to Vienna. Ivar Oxhall is a Norwegian who went to America when he was a baby, came back as a little boy when his father died, and grew up in Norfjord. And always, after we met in 1980, he always used to kid me. He used to say, it's not Vienna, it's Norway. It's Norway, that's where Wittgenstein really thrived, and that's where the ideas came. Well, it's all turned out to be true. I mean, I sort of chuckled at first. Over the last 35 years, considerably less. And Ivar was also instrumental in the foundation of the Wittgenstein Archives in Bergen. He was around. He didn't bring any money. He didn't bring any ideas, but he did bring a whole lot of goodwill that made Professor Anscombe, who was an extraordinarily difficult woman, if she was a woman, well, she had 8 children. She must have been. He was instrumental in converting her, and also Professor von Richt, into fans of the idea that there should be a project like the Bergen Project. Now, we've talked about architecture in the house. He was the first person ever to suggest that this house should be put back where it was. And he was talking about this over 30 years ago. And he went there as one of the first and talked to Harald Vatne, who's has been the overseer of this property for many years, about this whole business. So it precisely because Ivar Oxhall is not a household name that everybody is familiar with, I would like to remember this. I'd like to remember him today. Thanks very much.
Thank you very much. Please introduce yourself.
One short remark, which has to do with Vienna 1900. We remember the famous espionage affair Oberstredel. Oberstredel was one of the main traitor of the chief general plans for Austria's war against Tsarist Russia. But it came out that he had some homosexual lovers. And this was not a secrecy. In most of the cadet schools of the Austrian army at that time, hidden homosexuality was a hidden practice. It was known, but it was not openly spoken about. So if you were outed as a Jew and a homosexual in Vienna around 1910, you would have been a complete outsider.
Yeah.
Thank you very much. Other voices from the audience? Yes?
Thank you for this very interesting presentations. I would like to make a short remark. What Alois said was very interesting for me, that the beginning of the Urfass, so the manuscript 142 of the Philosophical Investigations, was exactly at the same time of his so-called confessions. And I was reminded that Stanley Cavell said in the Claim of Reason, that the whole style of the investigations is the style of a confession. So in a very, also in a religious sense, it has all characteristics of a confession. And we should also not forget that Augustinus, his main work, which Wittgenstein knew and appreciated a lot, has also the title Confessions.
And that's what he begins with.
The beginning of the investigation is a quotation from there, of course. So I think this is a very interesting coincidence that Wittgenstein starts to write his big work of his later time and makes these confessions. I was not aware of this. It's really interesting. And I would like to ask you, would you agree that the whole style of the investigations is a kind of confession? This has to do with the question how close is philosophy and biography, of course. And as you said, they cannot be separated, really. I think this is exactly the point, because if it is a confession, it's a kind of personal confession, of course.
So what happened there on the house in Scholln at the beginning of November? Well, I think we can see here the connection between philosophy and the person. So if philosophy, as he would say, is struggling with problems of the will rather than intellectual problems, that you have to change your attitude to things, to your own questions and so, then we maybe can say that there he let go of certain ideals or idols that he was captivated himself also during the Brown Book Project, and that freed him to do the confession and to write investigations as he did then. Now you ask, can we say they are written in a confessional style? Well, at least they are probably as much as we can say they can be. He calls them an album. So what he basically does there is trying not to fit them into one coherent whole and fit them together into series. He wants to leave these remarks as much as possible as they are in their context when they were written, and now he puts them together, he composes them. So in that sense, there is a confessional element there that you do simply try to state and be objective to the facts, and he tries to be there then objective to his philosophizing since 1929 and composes out of his philosophizing since 1929 the investigations. Not that he had these books all with him, but he had the text in his memory. He really carried lots of remarks with him around in his memory. So I would say, yes, there is something to it.
There's a dissertation that was written this year that I was the outside reader on by a young woman at the University of Washington on confession in Wittgenstein in relation to other writers and so forth, beginning with Augustine and Astra. I mean, I think she overdid it a little bit, but I was just the outsider on it, but it was interesting. And I would just want to come back to one other point, and that's that you said, but after all the philosophy as we know it, he never talks about sexuality. Doesn't that mean something? I mean, look at all the examples in the investigations. Tons and tons and tons of examples, let's say, of children's games, of all kinds of games. When we're talking about language games, there could be examples. Musil, who was in a way, you could call a Wittgensteinian, who had similar views, when he gives examples of anything, it's always a boy and a girl and things that happen. And the fact that none of the examples are, it's curiously asexual, the investigations. Mm-hmm. And I read that as also meaning that Wittgenstein wanted to be aesthetic. He didn't want to be sexual. I mean, that's something that he was, but he was ashamed of it. That goes on. Mm. I think so. I think so, definitely, that he didn't feel comfortable about it any more than with his Judaism. And what he really would have aspired to is, this comes up again and again in the remarks on Fraser and so forth, he had such an admiration for the Gospels, he had such an admiration for Christ, he wanted to be an ascetic in a way, and he was ascetic. He lived in that room with the one deck chair in Cambridge and so forth. He certainly didn't care much about food, he didn't care about these things. He wanted to get away from sensual pleasures. And that actually shows up in the investigations in curious ways, because the examples, if we say a dog can be said to be waiting for his master, but not to be waiting for his master to come on Wednesday. Or if a lion could speak, he would not understand us. All the examples, but you could, now think about it, all those examples could have been with a woman or something like that, could have been possibly, and they're not. And so I think there is a one could almost say a concerted effort not to deal, no, that, not, that sexuality is not important. And I think the philosophers have picked up on that. It isn't important.
Thank you very much. We will hear one more person from the audience in the front here.
Only a very short remark to you, Alois, when you mentioned before that Wittgenstein philosophized and keeping, when philosophizing, his sexuality out. Not completely, I think not in the classroom. John Findlay told me at a long walk in Graz that he was thrown out of Wittgenstein's seminar, or he was told by Wittgenstein in not a very nice way he shouldn't come anymore, and he said he was completely convinced, and John Findlay was an eminent philosopher in his own right in the end, because of his looks. He said Wittgenstein wanted to have students with a certain type of look, a certain type of way of looking. That's as well probably why he had many surrounded himself with this young man, and John Findlay said he was simply not good looking enough. He was too ugly for Wittgenstein. That's why Wittgenstein didn't want to have him there. Mm-hmm. Thank you.
Thank you very much. I'm gay myself, and I would say that Wittgenstein has a good taste in men. Yeah.
How do I?
Good taste in men. His judgment is very good when it comes to aesthetic qualities in the men he liked. That was just a personal remark. let's wrap up now. Thank you so much to Professor Pichler, Kjetil Tredal Thosen, and Professor Perloff. Just let me end by a quote from Wittgenstein's diaries. In the spring of 37, he had done lots of good work on the first 188 paragraphs of Philosophical Investigations. But then his work began to falter, and he explained it to George Edward Moore as a consequence of thinking too much about himself. And he summed up his problem in his diary in a way that shows the philosopher also as a writer with literary and poetic qualities. He writes in Scholden in the spring of 37, "It's winter in my soul. My thought moves as slowly as if it had to wade through deep snow. The light that work sheds is a beautiful light, which, however, only shines with real beauty if it is illuminated by yet another light." Thank you for coming, and welcome back at 7.